Arrancamos o Jornal da Noite Canadá do Civic Holiday com uma entrevista à deputada federal Julie Zerwitz, eleita por Devonport, o distrito eleitoral onde residem mais portugueses e lusodescendentes no Canadá. Entre os vários assuntos, numa conversa comigo, a deputada federal explicou o projeto de lei da sua autoria que apresentou na Câmara dos Comuns e que estabelece um rendimento básico garantido no Canadá para os cidadãos que estejam a passar por algumas dificuldades económicas. Além disso, Julie Zerwitz também revelou algumas informações importantes para a comunidade portuguesa, nomeadamente a nível do trabalho e da imigração. Não perca esta entrevista e saiba todas as novidades já a seguir.
MP Julie Zerwitz, thank you and welcome back to Correio da Manhã Canadá. It is always a pleasure to have you back in our channel. The last time we spoke, we discussed the New Horizons for Seniors program, which is, for those who don't know, a program that, including obviously other things, it promotes volunteerism amongst seniors and other generations. But let's start off with one of the most, if not the most important issue that is still affecting the country. It has been 16 months ever since the COVID-19 pandemic hit the country and the world. And with the vaccination efforts to put an end out on this virus, and also Ontario's stepping into phase 3 of the reopening plan, how is the vaccine process going in the province and also around Canada?
Well, first, Teresa, it's a pleasure for me to be here. Obrigada pelo convite. Federal government delivered 55 million doses to the provinces and territories, okay? So that means from the time we started delivering it, which would have been sort of December, January of late last year, early this year, to yesterday at 4 p.m., we delivered 55 million doses, and 46.6 million have already been given into the arms of Canadians, whether it's first dose and second dose, okay? In Ontario, we're around, well, in Toronto, I know for sure we're around 80% double dose, and in and around 60% double dose, and single dose is 80%. Okay, so which is really good for Toronto. So I want your viewers to know that the federal government buys all the vaccines, but it's up to the provinces and territories to distribute, and they've been doing a really great job at distributing that. And Canadians are also doing a great job of getting vaccinated. And my message to Canadians is to keep on getting vaccinated, because if we want in Ontario to get to step 4, we're currently in step 3, we have to see the vaccination numbers go up. Here's what I know about step 4. So under step 4, what Ontario has told us so far is that it's almost back to normal, okay? So starting August 6, it would allow 1,000 people indoors, up to 15,000 people outdoors, but we have to reach a threshold for 80% one shot, which we already have, which is great, and 75% fully vaccinated, okay? So we still have a way to go. And so what I would say to people is please make sure, if you haven't had a chance to get first dose or second dose, there's big vaccination clinics that are coming up this weekend, but keep an ear out to your newspapers, your TV programs, your radio stations. They're all announcing the latest in terms of where's big vaccination sites. And there's lots of flexibility as to when you can actually go and be vaccinated.
So on February 22nd this year, you have introduced Bill C-273, so the first bill ever towards a national guaranteed basic income that is being petitioned online. So the bill entered second reading on the 14th of last June. And for those who are unaware or haven't even heard about the bill yet, I would like MP Julie for you to explain what is the goal of establishing a guaranteed basic income in Canada? How are Canadians going to benefit from this?
So thank you so much, Teresa, for that excellent question. Guaranteed basic income, many people think that guaranteed basic income is just going to give free money to people every month so that they sit at home. It's not that at all. I am the daughter of immigrant parents. We work very hard. But my mother would say to you, and my mother has been here for about 50 years, her English isn't very good, And she doesn't exactly understand guaranteed basic income, but what she knows is that the world that I live in and my sister and brother live in is very different. You don't have the same job for 30 years. Most jobs don't have benefits. There's a lot of instability in the marketplace, okay? And the world of work is changing faster than ever before. So, and the systems that we have, so the employment insurance system that we have, that we put in place, we created in 1940s here in Canada, it is not modern enough to meet the needs of supporting Canadians in the 21st century, given our job market. So when I explained to my mom that, look, it's basically a new foundation to our social welfare system, it would replace something like employment insurance, but it would provide more stability, sufficient funding on a monthly basis. It won't pay for all of your costs, but sufficient funding so that you're not worried about how am I going to have enough money to eat. It will encourage work, minimize fraud, and reduce overall government costs, okay? So that is what I'm proposing, is that overall, we provide a better support system for Canadians in the 21st century, because we know the world of work is changing. It's changing faster than ever before. We're being threatened by automation and artificial intelligence. So we need a system that better supports us. So overall, the cost shouldn't be more than what we have when we change to a new system. So that's what I'm proposing to do. It's just giving us all that stability to be able to, you know, retrain if we lose a job, or upskill if we lose a job, or catch our breath and take not any job that comes available, but sort of be thoughtful about, well, let me take a couple of extra weeks to actually sort of be looking for a job that pays better, that meets my skills, that meets my education levels, so that I can better support my family and reach my own potential. And us doing that is better for Canada, because the more that we allow Canadians to reach their potential, the better and more successful Canada will be.
Well, I think that explains it very well, and it's, I think it's going to be very clear for our audience, because there isn't guaranteed basic income. It was not very clear for a lot of people in our community. So you are very, very close to getting the 34,000 signatures for the bill, with less than 1,500 to go. What happens next as soon as you hit the target?
So what I'd say is right now, so I've already done a first hour, second reading. So I still have a second hour, second reading. So, you know, when the House of Commons comes back into session this fall, hopefully, you know, I will do second reading and a vote. And then we go into third reading. So hopefully that process continues. The petition and all the extra sort of signatures, why that's really powerful is because essentially it's telling people like our Prime Minister and our Deputy Prime Minister, Minister of Finance, that Canadians really support this idea. And so that's the power that this petition and all of these voices lends to the discussion that we're having about how do we better support Canadians in the 21st century. And I'll just mention one more fact to you. We have employment insurance in Canada, but only 40% of Canadians are actually eligible for employment insurance in Canada. So again, we don't have a system that is, you know, that is, in my opinion, modern enough to meet the current needs of the 21st century. And I just want to make sure the community knows this is not about keeping people at home. It is about providing stability and better support for people to get their next job, to train and retrain. It will minimize fraud, and our overall cost for the program and our social welfare system should be the same. Okay.
So let's
hold on. Okay. We're ready.
So let's talk about the 2021 budget. Unemployment is a thready issue in Canada at the moment. Many people lost their jobs due to the pandemic, but also it is said that there aren't very many workers available, especially for qualified jobs. What is being done in regards to this what employment supports are there for these people in Canada?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. So the federal Liberal government last fall promised that we would create 1 million new jobs. So we're about 70% of the way there, okay? So at the height of the pandemic, 13.2% of Canadians were unemployed. Now the unemployment rate is 7.8%. So we're good. And before the pandemic started, we were around 5.5%. Okay, so we're almost back to our pre-COVID pandemic level employment level. So that's good. So I will say to you right now, the focus of our national government is on helping businesses rehire. We've created something called a Canada Hiring Benefit. And we've also, we're encouraging Canadians who are able to do so to go back to work, because we know that there is a lot of jobs that are available there. What some Canadians are worried about, to be fair, Teresa, because I talk to a lot of small businesses and I talk to a lot of people who are looking for jobs. Some workplaces they don't feel are safe, okay, to go back to. So there are still some COVID restrictions, right? So maybe a kitchen that was set up before that was okay before the pandemic is okay, but now you might need to create some extra cleaning stations, spacing mechanisms to make a Canadian worker feel more safer to work in a particular kitchen or restaurant or particular retail store, like, or wherever it is that there that jobs are available. So I just say to employers, make sure you're creating safe workplaces that will keep your employees safe. And then to all those that are looking for a job, you know, there's lots of amazing opportunities that are out there. You know, we have a website called jobbank.gc.ca and lots of jobs, both for students during the summer, even though we're in July, there's still a few things left, or for those who want to just sort of have ongoing work, go to jobbank.gc.ca.
And while we are talking about the 2021 budget, talk us through a little bit about the program on national childcare, the national childcare plan, please.
Yeah, that's another great thing. So budget 2021, it's a historic spending of about $100 billion. Okay, so it's a huge investment. A big part of that budget is to continue to support businesses as we're coming out of COVID. So the wage subsidy, the rent subsidy, you know, some of the digital sort of upgrading for our small businesses and just general supports for Canadians. But a big chunk of that budget as well is around implementing finally a national childcare plan. So this isn't something we're just talking about. We've been talking about it for 50 years in Canada. This is about implementing it. We have $30 billion in our budget allocated. And what we're doing right now, our Prime Minister has been busy going across the country and signing agreements with British Columbia, Nova Scotia's come on side, and we're hoping the other provinces are going to slowly come on side as well. And what it'll promise is, basically the model is by the end of next year, which is 2022, childcare costs will be reduced by 50% in your respective province, okay? And by 2026, so about 5 years, it'll move to an average of $10 a day, okay? The reason it takes us 5 years and we can't do it tomorrow is when you're first you have to create the spaces. So you have to find the spaces for childcare. Then you have to increase the number of daycare, teachers or, you know, caretakers, you know, and so that's gonna take time for us to get people into the school system, trained up properly, and then getting those jobs. So that takes us a while. So that's why it's gonna take up to 5 years for us to deliver the final, on average, $10 a day childcare. But again, Ontario government, so Premier Ford has to knock on the door of Prime Minister Trudeau and say, Prime Minister Trudeau, we want to get into this national childcare plan, and we have to have a negotiation, because the federal government, while we give the money, it is dependent on the province to actually deliver the program.
And let's change a bit of the subject. This time we can go through the immigration issues that I've been going through. Before we start our interview, we were discussing a little bit about how the Portuguese community need to be aware of some of the immigration laws and measures. Talk us through that, please.
Sure. There's probably three key things in terms of messages for the Portuguese community. So first is many Portuguese have been waiting to go back to Portugal, and they've been waiting to get their second dose, and many of them are getting it. But Because for those Portuguese that do not have Canadian citizenship but have to renew their permanent residency card, they have to know that the current processing time is 99 days. So I say to them, if you're planning to go, whether it's September or October, you really have to make sure your permanent residency card is not expiring when you are leaving, and please put in your application right away. The second thing I would say is one of the big things I've been working on it for 5 years and 7 months that I have been a member of parliament. And I made a big proposal to our minister and very senior people within our government to normalize non-status workers. So we have a lot of people with no status. They're working, you know, not only my riding of Davenport, but across our country. And so right now there's what we're able to do is we have what we call a construction pilot. Okay. So we introduced this pilot about 2 or 3 years ago, but not many people apply to it. So this is for non-status workers who work in the construction field. You're able to apply through the Canadian Labour Congress. You just go to the Canadian Labour Congress website and you just find, you know, construction pilot for non-status workers. But essentially what it is we can help you normalize and become a permanent resident through that process. And it's not only just you, like the person who works in the construction industry, but it's also their family, their wife, their kids, anybody who's here with them, okay? Before, we required everybody to have a certain level of language skills. That now has changed. You don't have to meet any language requirements, okay? You can apply and say you only have level 3 or level 2 sort of English, that's okay. You know, that will not stop you from having a successful application. The other thing that we required was that, the two other things. One is that you had to file a income tax in Canada. We have eliminated that requirement. And then the other thing that we had to have was that you had to have come in on a work permit or, you know, some sort of legitimate way. But if you came as a visitor and ended up becoming a worker, you can also apply, okay? So I really want to encourage people, if you're working in the construction sector, if you don't have a status, you know, please apply. You're applying through the Canada Labour Congress. Go to their website, look for construction pilot or out of, you know, status or non-status construction pilot, or go through your unions, whether it's the Painters Union or whether it's the Layuna, they will also have all the information and will also help you to apply. So I really encourage people to really put in their applications. If anyone has any questions or problems, they can also call me at my office and my team's very happy to help them and to serve them.
Are there any subjects that we haven't touched upon that are deserving pointing out?
Well, there's many. So I will mention a couple of things just because I love them so much and I miss them because I haven't had a chance to go to Casa das Beiras or Casa da Alentejo, Casa das Ores, you know, or Madeira. I haven't been able to go to many, or Arsenal do Minho. I haven't been able to go to many of these clubs, and I usually see, you know, the Portuguese population out. But I want them to know a couple of key things. For those that are parents, I know that I talked about a national childcare, but for those who are parents of children 6 and under, they are going to receive an extra $1,200 this year to provide some additional support. We know it's been so difficult during the pandemic to stay at home. And so they've needed some additional dollars to cover some costs. So they got $600 on May 28th. There's another $300 coming on July 30th and the last $300 in October. Okay. The next thing for me to mention is seniors. You know, our seniors really, really had a hard time during this pandemic. So what I want to let them know is two key things. One is that for those that are 75 years old and over, we are increasing the old age security by 10%, okay? So that means it starts next year. So you'll get each person 75 and older in the household who gets OAS will get $766 more. And then this year, because we still have to have time to implement the new system, we're going to give all seniors the week of August 16 an extra $500. But that's for those seniors 75 and over. OK, but it's a big deal. If you have like a husband and wife who live in a house and they're both 75 and older, well, that's an extra $1,000 a year, and that's a lot of extra money, which is really great. The last thing I'd say is we have a lot of young, amazing people like you, Teresa, many of them, really had a hard time with, university and going to post-secondary education. So our federal government, or many of them have finished school and they're now coming out into this post-pandemic world. So the federal government is doing three key things. One is we want people to know you can afford to go to post-secondary education, college or university, because the federal government is going to double the amount of grants, which is basically if you're applying for loans, and say you need $2,000, the federal government is doubling the amount of grants we give you, which is the amount of money we give you. And we're also making it much easier for you to, once you finish your school, to repay your loans. So your Canada student loans, whatever loans you do take out. Before, you had to earn $25,000 before you had to start paying back your Canada student loans after your program finishes. But now we've increased that to $40,000. So you have to earn a minimum of 40 before you start paying back. So I think those are key things that I wanted to mention. I'll also mention about housing. A lot of Portuguese, they love only houses. So many of them in the community actually own houses, but they're worried about their kids. They're worried about how are their kids ever going to be afford a home. Many years ago, their kids could move to Mississauga, or Brampton, or Kleinberg, elsewhere, and they could find a home that's affordable. Now it doesn't matter where you live. It doesn't matter where you go. You can't find a place. What the message I want to send to them, our prime minister knows that this is a problem. The solution is we have to work with the province and municipality to be able to find a solution, okay? So the message to the community is we don't have an immediate solution for tomorrow, but we know that this is a top priority for us. And so we are working very hard to address this issue. So in the coming weeks and months, people should start hearing some of the key things that we want to do. Okay. So that's an important thing for us to talk about. But if I had to leave a final message to the community, I would say two things to them. One is I want to say to them a huge thank you. Many of them really stepped up during the pandemic. We had groups from Casa das Horas and Casa de Alentejo. They would come together in the kitchen and they would make food for mostly Portuguese families who were in need of food, particularly those who had palliative care needs, and just a big heart to them. We had a number of Portuguese grocery stores in my riding of Davenport step up and provide free food delivery for those who weren't able to get to the store because they felt it was unsafe. And they also try to keep their prices, affordable so that people can continue to afford it. So I just a big heart to the community for stepping up and to really helping each other and helping our overall community during this really tough pandemic. The other thing I want to say is the community also had a very hard time. And it was not just Portuguese community. This is a lot of Canadians really hated this, but they really did not like the quarantine hotels when they were coming back from Portugal. Many of them had family emergencies or family deaths that forced them to leave the country and then forced them to come back. And I know they paid extra money. I know they felt they would prefer to be safer in quarantine in their own house. But I just want to say thank them for their patience. And I want to thank them for getting through this. The decision was made not because, the federal government made a decision, not because we want to make people suffer. It really was because overall we had to minimize the threat and the risk of COVID coming back into our country. And we were going through a very, very, very difficult time between January and about end of May. And so those were the extra measures we had to put in place. So I just want to say huge heartfelt thanks to all of them for their patience and for getting through this. And now we're over on the other side and we all have to just continue to follow public health directives. We're not safe until our public official says we're safe because no one wants to go back into a lockdown anymore. And we want to stop wearing our masks as well, outside and inside.
You have been a very great member of parliament and have been representing very well our Portuguese community in Davenport. And I'm thankful for that. I wish you all the best and keep safe.
Muito, muito obrigada and bom dia.